Liver is a self-regulating organ that detoxifies itself. But can things like schisandra, artichoke, or milk thistle and other nutrients that we will discuss today help? We'll see. I'll give you a blueprint for a simple 3-step process that you can follow to help your liver do its job more effectively, starting from the least and finishing with the absolutely most important. But I'll also discuss why the concept of liver detox extends far beyond what specific foods or drinks you consume. So let's look at some of the herbs that have been shown to promote liver detox. And it will start with schisandra. Schisandra is a plant used in traditional Chinese medicine for centuries. In addition to its ability to support the immune system, increase the body's endurance and resistance to stress and fatigue, schisandra also stimulates enzymes in the liver that promote liver cell growth. Studies have shown that schisandra helps to reduce the severity of fatty liver disease by decreasing the accumulation of fat in the liver and inhibiting the production of inflammatory substances that cause liver cell damage. Now let's talk about artichoke. Artichoke helps to increase both production of the bile in the liver as well as movements of the bile from the liver. This will help to eliminate toxic substances from the liver through the bile more effectively. Now, producing more bile helps with digestion of fats and absorption of various vitamins from food, since you need bile to digest the fat. It's been also found that extract from artichoke helps to improve blood circulation in the liver and regenerate the liver cells in general. This works great together with the milk thistle, which we'll be discussing next. You can eat the artichoke steamed as a side dish or take it as an extract. Now, milk thistle is my favorite herb. I've used it many times with my patients with various liver diseases and it works really great. The active ingredient is silymarin, which promotes the liver cell's regeneration and has anti-inflammatory effect. Now, we will talk more about why protein is crucial in liver detox later on, but for now, I want to mention that silymarin helps to increase protein synthesis in the liver, which helps in the creation of new liver cells. This has been shown to be effective in patients with alcoholic and non-alcoholic liver diseases. Milk thistle also has anti-inflammatory effect, which is believed to be due to the silymarin's ability to inhibit activation of certain immune cells, which plays key role in the liver inflammation. Now let's look at step two, which includes foods that we should include in our diet to support the liver function. Now let's start with the beetroot. A compound found in a beetroot called betaine helps the liver process fat and stimulates the liver cell function. It also protects the liver and bile ducts. Fat accumulation in the liver can lead to various disorders, so the beetroot's ability to process fat in the liver more efficiently can be beneficial in preventing this. Beetroot is also high in fiber, which helps to regulate bowel movement. Now, this is quite important because regular elimination of waste is crucial for the liver's detoxification process. That's because most toxins are expelled from our body through the bowel. To incorporate beetroot into your diet, you can either juice it or eat it cooked. Now, if you are going to make the beetroot juice, to get the most out of it, it's recommended to use it on empty stomach. About 1 to 2 tablespoons a day is enough. But for some people, it can be a little bit too strong. In that case, it helps to let the juice sit in the refrigerator for a couple hours. Now, let's talk about protein. When you eat food that contains protein, like chicken, fish, beans, and so on, your body breaks down the protein into amino acids, which are the building block of protein. Your liver needs the amino acids from the protein that you eat so that it can do the detox process. That's because detoxification in the liver happens in two phases. In phase one, the liver changes the structure of the toxin to prepare those toxins for elimination from the body. Unfortunately, this process creates so-called intermediates, which are compounds that may be actually even more toxic to the body than the original toxin. That's why there is a phase two of the liver detox. In phase two, the liver uses the amino acids from the protein that you eat and combines these amino acids with the intermediate compounds created in phase 1. This creates less harmful water-soluble substances. Now, these substances are then easily excreted through the kidneys or intestines. Now, if you have insufficient protein in your diet, that can have very negative effect on phase 2 detox, which can lead to buildup of toxic substances in your body. Now, you also need to think about the fact that liver is largely made out of protein. Therefore, having adequate protein intake is crucial just to maintain the general health of the liver and its structure. So, how much protein should you eat? Well, if I tell you the general recommendation is for about 0.8 grams per kilogram of body weight for a generally healthy person, is that really going to help you? I don't think so. So look, unless you are on some kind of very restricted diet for whatever reason, which is a different story, if you eat regular food, you generally don't need to worry about not getting enough protein. The main thing though is to choose healthy sources of protein that will not bring more harmful substances in your body with that protein. Considering things like chicken, turkey, fish. Now when you're talking about fish, we're talking about fish with low content of mercury. Eggs, beans, and nuts, all these are great places to start. Now I suggest you to look at my video on omega-3 in the description below to help you choose the best sources of fish which have low content of the neurotoxin mercury and high content of omega-3s. Now let's talk about cruciferous vegetables. Broccoli, Brussels sprouts, cabbage, kale, they all contain sulfur compounds that make the enzyme in phase 2 of liver detox that we just discussed work much more efficiently. This means that these vegetables are great for breaking down and neutralizing the toxins in the liver. Some research suggests that compounds in these vegetables may also have anti-inflammatory properties, which can be beneficial for liver health since chronic inflammation can lead to liver damage over time. Now, I also want to mention that cruciferous vegetables have antioxidant properties that neutralize harmful free radicals that can damage liver cells and interfere with the normal functioning of the liver. Now let's move to the most important step, and that's step 3. The core concept here is to stop looking for things that will help you detox your liver and instead start looking for things that prevent your liver from doing its natural detox job. Trust me if I tell you that your liver will do the rest. Without implementing the following strategies, you can forget about anything I told you so far. So let's start with absolutely the most important one, and that's excessive alcohol intake. But what is excessive alcohol intake? You know, I had a patient once that I asked, "How much you drink?" He said, "Oh, not much, doc." Alright, so how much is not much? Well, just a bottle of vodka a day. So yeah, we need to define what is considered excessive from the perspective of our health and not individual's understanding, which as you can see can be quite skewed. Now CDC defined excessive drinking for men as the consumption of 15 or more drinks per week and 8 or more drinks per woman. Now drink is generally considered to be about 14 grams or 0.6 ounces of pure alcohol, which is typically found in 12 ounces of beer, 5 ounces of wine, and about 1.5 ounces of distilled spirits, such as vodka, whiskey, or gin. Now keep in mind that binge drinking, which is drinking a large amount of alcohol in a short period of time, typically about 5 or more drinks for men and about 4 or more drinks for women in about 2-hour period, also falls into the category of excessive drinking. So why is alcohol so bad? Now alcohol is metabolized in the liver, but the process generates toxic byproducts like acetaldehyde and reactive oxygen species that can cause inflammation and damage to the liver cells. Over time, this can lead to fatty liver disease called steatosis, where the fat builds up in the liver. If the liver inflammation lasts long enough, the inflammation can cause alcoholic hepatitis and eventually progress to scarring of the liver and liver cirrhosis, which will reduce the liver's ability to do the detox and metabolize nutrients and process the waste products. So the point is that it really doesn't matter how much artichoke or milk thistle you take. If you drink heavily, your liver will not work properly. Now let's talk about fat. Getting rid of deep fried food from fast food restaurants is absolute must to do. These foods are loaded with trans fatty acids and other chemicals which are produced when the oil is reused for frying multiple times. When you eat food high in fat, this creates chances for fat infiltrating your liver. This ultimately contributes to the development of non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, known as NAFLD, and obviously will impair the liver's ability to detox the substances in your body. Now, what lots of people don't realize that excessive intake of fat also disrupts the balance of gut bacteria, which leads to dysbiosis, a fancy term that means an imbalance in your gut bacteria. Decrease in the beneficial bacteria and overgrowth of potential harmful microorganisms in your gut has been linked to liver dysfunction and impaired detoxification process. That's because your gut microbiota, all the bacteria in your guts, plays important role in metabolizing and elimination of toxins. Excessive fat intake also strains the liver, since the liver needs to process and metabolize all the fat that you eat. Over time, this can lead to liver dysfunction and compromise the liver's ability to do its detox process effectively. The bottom line here is that if you eliminate fried food and other foods high in fat and eat regular food, you'll be doing great. I also suggest that you replace the soybean oil, cottonseed, and sunflower oil with olive oil and canola oil to further decrease the inflammatory pathways in your body that these oils promote. Now let's talk about processed food and sugar. Now the fact that we should minimize processed foods and foods high in sugar in our diet is, I think, pretty obvious. Not only do their consumption result in accumulation of fat in the liver, which can ultimately lead to non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, NAFLD, but in some cases it can even lead to liver inflammation, which we already discussed. Now obviously there are many other important factors that can burden your liver and prevent it from doing its normal detoxification process. Things like taking too many medications, especially those over-the-counter pain medication, smoking, physical inactivity, obesity, and insulin resistance all make it very hard for your liver to do its normal day-to-day detoxification job. So let's put it all together. If you follow this simple blueprint, your liver is going to be grateful. The beauty is that you don't actually have to add anything special to your diet if you don't want to or if you can't do it. All you need to do is to be mindful of all the major factors that are discussed in the step 3 and let your liver do what it does best. If you add foods from step 2 to your diet, you are already a winner. Adding any of the herbs from step 1 or any other herb that helps to support the liver function is really optional, and it is best suitable for those who already implemented most of the things from step 2 and 3 and now are looking at fine-tuning the function of their liver even further. But by no means are any of the herbs mentioned in step 1 necessary for you to take to detoxify your liver. Now, if you should take only one thing from this video, then I really hope that now you understand why any of the special cocktails of vegetable juices or herbal supplements that are supposed to detox your liver will not work if you do not address the biggest factors in step 3 that prevent your liver from doing its job. I strongly suggest you to also look at a video of why you should stop eating sugar if you are serious about helping your body work more efficiently. The link is in the description below. Until then, I see you next time.